Hello. I'm very happy to have a chance to talk and introduce you with Richard and Christian, local experts from Johannesburg. Welcome. Johannesburg is the largest city of South Africa, a country which is often seen as the most unequal countries in the world. For the Global Segregation book, you prepared a chapter where you analyze inequality and segregation and changes over time in Johannesburg. It is a very special city. For many people, when they think about South Africa in relation to inequality, the first word that comes to mind is apartheid. So tell us about the post-apartheid city and the continuities and changes of the urban space related to apartheid policy.
Thank you very much, Ruta, for this opportunity. It's really great to be in conversation with you. So this is a contemporary map of Johannesburg, and it is showing the population as it is today, around 5 million people living in the city. And you will see that this particular map is arranged to show us how different races are distributed. So these are racial categories as defined under apartheid, still measured today. What you see here is that every blue dot represents 200 black African people. Every pink dot represents 200 white people. Every orange dot represents 200 Indian people, and every green dot represents 200 colored people. So it gives you a good idea of racial distribution within the city. So apartheid really intended to relocate people by race. You'll see a settlement here for colored people, another for Indian people. And most of the suburbs to the north were for white people. And all of these were intended to have space to grow outwards. That's really what the apartheid city was. And you can see in today's representation how strongly that worked. So today there are a number of continuities. You can see that in the northern suburbs, areas originally set aside for white people, this is where white people tend to still live because they can afford to do so. You can see the townships are still predominantly, almost overwhelmingly black. And so there's still a lot of continuity. There's some very important changes, which is that white suburbs, as they were under apartheid, are now essentially desegregated. And you see over here on the right the reason for that, which is more affluent income categories have now become relatively mixed. White people are overrepresented there, but they are more mixed, and so a bigger range of people can afford to buy in these suburbs. The inner city in many places is actually in reasonably good condition, but it has transformed from a once white population to an entirely black population. They have tried to gentrify some sections. So there's an area called Maboneng, where some developers put a whole lot of money into, and it's extremely dynamic. It's quite an interesting place to visit. There's a lot going on there. The original developers have pulled out. So I think it's not entirely clear that that's a viable business model for developers, but there is something that continues to happen there on its own sort of organic steam. And sections of the inner city might become relatively elite, but it's not looking likely to displace a working class population from the inner city right now. So you can see very quickly that the areas that were once set aside for white residential areas have higher property values than areas that were once set aside as townships for a black working class. And so you can see a very distinct geography to property valuations within the city. So even without there being formal laws segregating people, this functions as a very hard filter on where it is that people can afford to live. The map on the right also gives us an idea of how certain kinds of construction are continuing to perpetuate these patterns. So all of these red areas are gated communities. Most of these would have been built since the late 1980s, mostly in the 90s and the 2000s, in the democratic era. And they extend outwards the originally white suburbs for now a mixed middle class group. Meanwhile, you can see in these green areas where government is planning to build housing or has built housing as welfare housing, there's Cosmo City, which is the example of a new housing settlement that perhaps doesn't locate welfare housing right next to an old township. It locates it next to closer to what were originally white suburbs. So that's a little bit more interesting. It mixes it up a little bit more. But quite often government projects don't do that. They don't mix things up very much. Each gray dot, and they kind of merge into a gray lump, those are informal dwellings. So what you're seeing there is representation of auto-constructed housing in a place like Soweto that's in amongst formal housing. A lot of the stock would have been built in the 50s and 60s, but then people build a shack in the backyard, and so it gets a gray dot. So that gives you an idea of further disaggregation of space by land use type, welfare housing, informal settlements, gated communities. These are all getting built in different parts of the city.
When we see this, the patterns that race is not that important anymore, it suggests that the mechanism of separation might be changing from race to class or income, but the degree of separation is still very high. In other analysis of Johannesburg, which we've done, it is also evident that class groups are growing further and further apart from each other in monetary terms, and that this is also linked to specific spatial patterns. For example, townships like Soweto and Diepsloot are becoming poorer and poorer, while the suburbs are becoming richer and richer. And it's also probably true that this trend will very likely be amplified by the long-term impact of COVID-19 on the city. So it's definitely not a positive trend to observe. In our analysis of Johannesburg, it was very interesting to clearly see the potential role that public housing developments can play, such as Cosmo City, but also the realization that this is limited to certain geographic scales and it requires significant support from the government to implement successfully. So for example, one of the developments that Richard has also mentioned is Cosmo City in this north western corner of the city. And you can see in 2001, this was essentially a low to middle income area. Whereas in 2011, it has changed much more to a middle income area, and it's brought those middle income occupations in closer contact to the high socioeconomic status area.
Richard, how does inequality manifest itself? I imagine two scenarios for the very unequal cities. So in one case, the city can be very much divided, but then the rich and the poor people would live in different parts of the city and they would attend different schools and visit different parts of the city. And in the second case, there can be a lot of mix and probably a lot of contrasts, and you can see this mix while walking the streets of the city. So which one is a case of Johannesburg?
When you refer to a scenario in which there's a lot of small-scale, fine-grained mixing, I think of, for example, some Indian cities where you find informal settlements leaning up against very fancy houses or fancy buildings. It can be incredibly close proximity. That is not really a good descriptor of Johannesburg. There are places where informal settlements are quite close to middle-class suburbs or gated communities even. And the map I've brought up is an example of that. But in general, the scale of distance between them is incredibly far. And even here, where you do have a higher level of proximity, we have Diepsloot in the north, and a few kilometers south, some very elite gated communities. This is about 4 kilometers distance, so it's relatively close proximity for Johannesburg. But you have you don't get that juxtaposition where you have an infusion of, say, informal settlements into higher income groupings. So they tend to remain extremely segregated.
What do you think is the role of urban planning and design in contemporary patterns of inequalities in Johannesburg? And do you think planning and design can help reduce inequalities in the city?
Yes, I think it definitely can. So urban planning begins at the policy level, and it's here where groundbreaking and innovative policies which help to reshape the city structure can be introduced. So quite recently, the city of Johannesburg introduced a new inclusionary housing policy. This policy essentially boils down to some measures where if a developer approaches the city in order to construct some new private sector housing, the city will allow them that development if the affordability of the units in that development is mixed. So for example, maybe they will be required to make 10% of the dwelling units in that development available to people who can only afford rental payments of up to 1,000 rand a month or something like that. And in that way, it will bring in some mixing of different socioeconomic groups into one development. So policies like the City of Johannesburg inclusionary housing policy is a very important product of the urban planning and could still help to significantly reshape the city structure. Urban planning policies are also important to link people to opportunities, for example, through transport, housing development, and also densification along transport corridors in order to link people with opportunities. The city of Johannesburg has also done quite a few policies which advocates for densification along transport corridors to achieve exactly this. Urban design, on the other hand, has a direct impact on the way in which people of different class groups, for example, can be included or then excluded from certain spaces in the city. So urban design is therefore very important to alter the lived experiences of the city and make the city equally enjoyable for everyone. So combined urban planning and design are also important tools that shape the direction of the investment in the city. Planning and design, when done with this intention, can definitely help to reduce inequality and segregation in the future.
Nice. And it sounds that these policies and initiatives really working, right?
Some of them are still very new, and there are some administrative challenges to them still. So we are still going to see the impact of them, but we think that it will have a significant impact in the future.
Well, I would say that aside from urban design issues where something proactive is happening from a planning stage, what's really happening in the city is that people are building shacks for themselves or gated communities for themselves, and they're following the spatial patterns that they're following. And that unless we see a reduction of the level of income inequality in the city, then those who are poor or unemployed will continue to have very little choice about where it is that they can live. And so you won't see a massive change in the structure of the city, whether we're talking about it in socioeconomic terms or the more racist terms that we have been presenting. And so the real game changer would be to have a lower Gini coefficient. And that doesn't seem very likely. We have very high unemployment levels. We don't have the economic basis to draw a lot of people into employment who need it. And so that means that the shape of what we see now is likely to be the shape in some decades to come as well.